everyone. So today in this lecture, I'm going to talk about how to determine the value of pi using this third method, which is Buffon's nipple. So sorry about the pronunciation, because Buffon is a French nobleman. So in this problem, I am going to discuss how to determine the value of pi using his problem, the Buffon's nipple. So what is the statement of the problem? The statement of the problem is as follows. So suppose that if I have dropped a short needle on a ruled paper. So you have a ruled, let's say you have a ruled notebook, and you have some needle, and you drop the needles into the paper. So now we want to know what is then the probability that the needle comes to lie in a position where it crosses one of the lines. So you have a ruled lines, ruled paper, and when the needle, we want to know the probability when one of the any number of the needle, so it will cross the one of the line, right? So you know that you have seen the ruled notebook. So there are lots of ruled lines which are parallel to each other. So when you throw a needle, so it can so happen that the ruled line, it will fall on the middle of the ruled line. There are another possibility, it will cross the ruled line, one of the ruled line or both of the ruled line. So there are three possibilities. So this is the, let's say this is the situation scenario. So there are ruled lines here, and these small things are the needle. So if you have thrown these needles inside this paper, so let's say some needles cross the ruled line, some needles cross this line, and but some of them will be inside this ruled line. That we not consider as that we don't want to know. We want to know how many of them are crossing the ruled lines, and some of them will cross both of the ruled lines and so on. So if this length L is equal to D, then some of them will cross both of them. But for our purposes, we are choosing that thing to be less than D. So D is the distance between the ruled lines, and L is the length of the needle, right? So now, so what is the probability that a needle will cross the any one of the ruled lines? So this, like this one, not, so we are not considering the case when they are inside the ruled line. So we are only considering the cases where it has crossed the one of the ruled lines, right? So as you can see from the picture, that it will obviously depend on the length of the needle, and the probability of crossing will depend on the length of the needle, the distance between the ruled lines, and also it depends on the value of pi. So how it depends on the value of pi, that we want to see first analytically, then numerically, right? So let's see. So now let's go for the analytical solution. Let's say these are the two ruled lines. Let's consider only two ruled lines, this and this, and this one is our needle of length L, and the distance between the ruled lines is D. And let's say the needle crosses the ruled line at an angle theta. Okay, so this distance is basically what, L cos theta, and this distance is L sin theta, and this is the length of the needle, so which is the upper hypotenuse. And then by Pythagoras theorem you can find this thing, and then not by Pythagoras theorem, you can just find that thing by tan theta is equal to this by this, and then you can find the ratios. So the horizontal component is basically L cos theta, and this thing is basically L sin theta, right? So now this distance is, let's say basically let's say this distance is basically g, and this distance is basically, what will be that distance, which is basically g plus this distance, which is L sin theta. So this distance is basically g plus L sin theta, and this distance is d, and this distance is g, and the angle of the needle with the ruled line is theta, and length of the needle is L. So when it will cross the so when g plus L sin theta is less than 0, that means it will cross it, and then when another case, it basically when it is greater than d, so it means it will cross the needle, it will cross the ruled line. So needle crosses a divided line. These two cases happens mean it will cross the ruled line. So let's see. So g plus L sin theta is this. When it is less than 0, means it is this is like this. So this means like this situation. So this situation happens means, so it will cross the needle, and when it is greater than d, let's say this distance, then also it will cross, because it will cross on the upper ruled line, because it is greater than d. So by these two cases happens when the needle crosses the ruled line. So now let's see how the probability depends on the value of pi. So now let's consider this needle. So this needle is length L, and it is at an angle theta with the horizontal line, rule line, and then the height of the this thing, height of the this distance is basically L sine theta. So now the probability that such a needle crosses one of the horizontal line of distance d is basically L sine theta by d, right? So the probability is basically this L sine theta by d. So this thing, and to find the probability, we have to average over all such thetas. So there will be several thetas from 0 to pi by 2. So then we have to average over all thetas, right? So this point you have to note, that the probability that such a needle cross one of the horizontal line is basically L sine theta, that is the this distance by that capital D distance, right? So this distance by D distance, and then we are averaging over all theta. So basically 0 to pi by 2, this thing into this theta, and this is basically 1 by pi by 2 is the averaging factor. So now, so we are averaging over all possible angle, and this is like an weight factor. As you can see, the weight averages over, if you want to average, then we have to divide by the factor pi by 2 minus 0. So this is basically the weight factor like a thing. And then if you integrate that whole the thing, then you will get 2L by pi d. So probability of crossing is basically 2L by pi d, which is L is the, so as our proposal, that it will depend on the distance d between the rule lines, length L of the needles. So basically this is L is the length of the needle, d is the distance between the rule line, pi also it depends on pi, because we have already said that length it will also depends on pi. So that is basically 2L by pi d. So p is basically 2L by pi d. Now this is how the pi comes into the picture. So now let's go to the numerical simulation. How can we simulate that thing numerically to find the value of pi? So now, so let's say if you drop a needle n times, right? So if you have a rule lines, then you drop a needle n times. So let's say you get p times, you get the intersection with the rule lines, right? So p by n basically will give you the probability, which is approximately equal to this 2L by pi d, right? So as we have seen that in the case of the coin tossing, and also when we are doing the multicolor simulation to find the value of pi using the square and circle things, then also we did the same thing. So here also we are doing the same thing. So in that case we did number of points inside the circle, total number of points. So the number of points inside the circle by the total number of points in the case of Monte Carlo simulation with square and circle to find the value of pi. So that I already gave a lecture on that thing. So if you haven't watched that thing, so you can always go there in my YouTube channel and you can watch that video. So that, because that will be good for you to understand this thing well. So in this case also, we throw a needle n times into a rule paper, and then we get, let's say, p times intersection. Then the probability is basically, probability of intersecting a rule line is basically p, the number of points it intersect, by divided by the total number of points, which is approximately equal to 2L by pi d. So from here this relation we can find the value of pi. So pi is basically 2L n by d into p, right? So this is how we can find the value of pi from this numerical simulation. So the algorithm is basically you have to call a random number. So this is the basic algorithm behind this simulation, which I am going to discuss next. So we have to call a random number r, then we have to define the gap, which is basically d into r, and then we have to call another random number, let's say r prime, and then we have to define the angle, which is basically r prime into 2 pi. So it can take any value between 0 to 2 pi, and then you have to define the distance, which I have discussed earlier, that this is basically g plus l sine theta, which is basically g plus l sine theta. So here also you have to calculate the distance g plus l sine of this angle. So then if distance greater than 0 and the distance less than g, if both these conditions satisfied, then we can increase a counter, which is counter basically counter plus 1, which is basically satisfy that condition when it is crosses the one of the rule line. Then so we have the count and we have the total number of points n, and then n count by n will give you the probability, which is basically 2L by pi d, and from there we can calculate the value of pi. So this is the basic algorithm behind this. So I will discuss the simulation, and I will write a simple code for you to simulate the Wolf's needle problem. So let's go to the code. So now let's write a code on this thing. Let's say we use FF Buffon dot F90, and then you have to type I, which is insert. Then you have to write a program. Let's say program buff and buffon implicit none. Now so you have to define several things. First define the integer part. So let's say you want to define an integer I and n, which is the number of points. So let's make n as a parameter, because we have to change n several times and we have to see that how it depends on the value of n. N is the total number of times you have thrown the needle. So let's take a value, let's say 10 times. So then we have to define another integer type variable, which is basically the counter for that counter. So let's make it counter. So initially the counter is basically 0, because we haven't because initially we start with that it has it, we haven't thrown anything. So initially that counter is 0. Okay, so then we have to use a do loop here. So do I is equal to 1 to n. So we are throwing n times. Then we have to call a random number from that algorithm. So we have to call random number, let's say r, or let's say x, it will be fine. Then you have to define the distance, which is basically that the distance I have already discussed, which is basically x star basically the g. So let's define this thing x and g. So basically that are a real type of variable. So let's define g and let's say x, and one thing that let's make g to be 1.0, right? Let's make g to be 1.0, and also I will set l to be 1.0, then it will be fine. So let's see. So next x into g, then basically you have to call a random number again, which is a different one. Let's say angle, let's say theta. So we have to define here theta. You have to declare that variable, and then you have to define that so theta is basically theta into 2 pi, 2 star let's say pi. So we have to define pi here. So we know why intrinsically we have to define pi, which is we can do it by a parameter, which is basically parameter. So then this is basically pi is equal to what? So we know that pi is basically tan inverse of 4 into tan inverse of 1, so 4.0 d0 star arc tan means tan inverse 1.0 d0, right? So this is how we define pi. So then tan into 2 pi, because this becomes the close interval 0 to 2 pi. So this is the range it will become. So the angle, the theta will be anywhere between 0 to 2 pi. So that's why we make it 0.0 to 2 pi. So let's say define the total distance, total d, which is basically distance plus l sine theta, as I already know. So I will define l to be also 1 for simplicity, sine of that theta, right? So let's define here L and make L to be 1 also. Sorry. So L to be 1.0 d0, right? Okay. So this is basically the total D is basically that thing that we have already discussed that. So here the total thing is basically this D plus L sine theta that we are doing basically. So let's see. So now let's say we have calculated the distance. Now we have to write the condition. Let's say if that let's enter bracket total d is greater than 0.0 d0, and so both the condition has to be satisfied, and total underscore d is less than the gap is basically 1, so we have to write gap only. Right, close that thing. Then if this satisfied, then increase the counter, because it means it crosses. Increase the counter by 1. So then end it, right? And then you have to close the end loop, do loop, and then you have to write the probability. So let's define another number, which is basically the probability, prob, P-R-O-B, and then here let's say P-R-O-B is basically what? So that is basically C counter divided by that total number of times you have thrown that thing. So this is the probability. So we know that this thing is equal to 2L by pi into D, right? As we have seen that the probability is basically 2L by pi D, right? So we have to equate that thing. So what is that thing? As I've already said that, so that is basically here, so 2ln by pi d. So we know this thing, that means we know 2l by pi d, that means 2l by pi d is known, d is 2l by d is pi d is known, then we have to find the value of the we have to find the value of that pi. So now what is that? That is 2ln by p. So this is basically okay, so 2ln, so let's see, let's print the value of pi. So the value of pi is, so what is that thing? So that is basically under bracket 2.0d02l, that is basically what, 2ln into dp. So d is 1, l is 1, right? So 2l n divided by the p means the counter, okay? So now this thing is basically probability is equal to counter value, this will be equal to 2L by pi, because L and D we have taken that to be 1. So this is basically 2L by pi. So we can do one thing rather than doing this. So that is basically, so 1 by probability will be pi by 2. So we have to do that 2.0d0 into divided by probability. That means we are doing that same thing, which is basically calculating the value of pi in program. So let's do that. So now anything else we need? We don't need anything. Now let's run the program. Let's see if we have an error. Then yeah, okay, we have an error. Distance have no type, and distance and gap we have to define. So sorry, so gap here means I have defined is with g. So sorry for that. And distance we have to define that to be a real type variable, distance, right? So okay, so anything else? So okay, nothing else. Total d you have to define, so we haven't defined that thing also, total d. So this thing, and then save it. Now clear the window. So now what you have to do is basically, when total d is basically, we know that distance plus of l sine theta that we have already described, and then when this thing is less than equal to 0 or the total d is greater than g, then we increase the counter by counter plus 1. That means the needle has crossed the rule line. So then the probability is basically the number of times it's crossed by the total number n. So that is basically the probability, which is basically 2l by pi d. And from this relation that I have already described, which is basically the 2l n by dp. So here in our case L and D are 1, so that is basically 2 into L n by p, which is basically the probability is basically p by n. So 2 by probability will give the value of pi. So that is basically 2 by probability will give the value of pi, because all that thing are 1, right? L and D are 1. So now let's see. So D in our case here is, I have defined as G, which is basically the gap. Now let's write it, and then let's make this thing, let's say make it 10. Let's see what happens. So let's clear the terminal and then let's see. So we are seeing that the value is pretty high from pt, low from the value of pi. So let's increase the bell number, which is 100. Let's make it 100. Let's see what happens. So now we are seeing that it is becoming closer and closer to pi. It's becoming 3.92. The pi is basically 3.14. You can also print the error with the actual value of pi. So let's print the error. So let's see. So print, let's say star, comma, error. So as you can see, you will see that as we increase the value of n, the error will decrease. So error is basically, what is the error? Let's say absolute value of the error is basically pi minus the value. This is basically 2.0 by probability. Right, this is the actual value of pi, and this is the value of pi we are getting from the simulation. So let's see. So let's clear it, and now let's see. So now, as you can see, the error is basically 0.36 something. Now if we increase the value of pi further, let's say value of the n further, let's say make it 1000, then let's see what happens. So as you can see, that this has become 3.194. That means the error is becoming 10 to the power order of 10 to the power minus 2. So as what you observe is basically, as you will increase the value of n, it will approximate the value of pi very closer and closer. Now let's see. Let's make it 10,000. Let's see what happens. Okay, as you can see that it becomes 3.15, which is basically the actual value of pi is basically 3.1415. So the error is becoming 10 to the power of minus 3. So now you can do it recursively. So let's see, let's do it recursively and plot the error, total number of times you have thrown the needle versus the error versus that thing. So let's make another thing. Let's say 1, 2, let's say n, let's say here. So let's say iter, and then let's make iter to be, let's don't say about anything a, let's say iter is basically, let's say iter is basically 10,000, and then make this as iter because we are doing the loop and we have to define integer n. So it don't need n, basically j going from 1 to iter, which is the number of times we have thrown. So that is, that loop is j. So instead of increasing that n by hand manually, we can do a loop, and then we can also plot the error versus the n curve. So I going from 1 to iter, and then we do the same stuff here, and then just instead of doing this chain printing over and over again in the screen, we'll write it in a file and we'll plot the error versus that curve, error versus the n curve, right? So let's do that. So there will be another loop here. So let's say basically write 25 comma star, which is basically we want to print n I, which is basically the I going from second loop, the j value, which is the second loop index, comma the error, which is basically absolute value of pi minus 2.0d0 by the probability, means the simulated value of pi, right? So this thing we want, and then we have to close that thing, close the first loop. So don't worry, I will describe everything after that. So what is we are doing is basically, so there is a first loop. This loop is basically instead of manually increasing the value of n, we are increasing by a loop. So it goes from 1 to 10,000, and this loop I will loop from 1 to iter. So it will last time we are doing n is equal to 10, means it is I is going from 1 to 10. N is equal to 100 means going from 1 to 100. Instead of doing it manually, we'll just make a loop here. So this loop will give a value of this loop BPL value will give a value of iter to this loop, and then it will simulate that thing and it will calculate the probability, and then we will calculate calculate the probability. then we calculate the probability using this thing and counter by real of j, because we are this for this particular loop, let's say j is equal to 5, so it I will go from 1 to 5, so that means this is basically real of j, that will be basically. So then we'll write that thing, write in a file that 25 comma star is j comma absolute of this thing, which is basically the error. We'll see that how the error will converge to 0. So let's see, let's open that file here. So let's really open a file 25 comma file is basically, let's say data dot dat, let's open it, and then it will write the file here, and then let's see what happens. Let's run the program. So here the pi is basically the actual value of pi, which I have defined here as a parameter, so it will intrinsically calculate the value of pi. So we don't need to, so okay, we have to define the j, because we haven't defined j as an integer. We have to declare the value of j, declare the variable j. So let's see, it will take some time because there are 10,000 moves. Okay, yeah, it's done. Then let's open gnuplot. So whenever we have a data set, you want to see the last generated data, which is basically the data dot dat, right? So let's clear the terminal and let's open gnuplot. Let's plot the thing. Let's set x, my x axis is basically, x level is basically what, which is basically the n, and my y level is basically what, y level is basically my error, right? And then let me just plot the thing, data dot dat, right, with l, let's say l will need to 9, let's see what happens. So as you can see, so this is our 3.14, which is the actual value, and as you can see, it is becoming closer and closer to the actual value, and it is the value of n, right? So this is how we can convert to actual value of, this is the like actual value of pi. So as you can see, at 0, in 0, it is basically fluctuating around very large value, and then as you increase the value of n, it will decrease, the error will decrease, and fluctuation will decrease. Eventually at n is equal to infinity, it will exactly calculate the probability and know exactly the value of pi simulation, right? So this is how we can study the Newton's little problem, and we can calculate the value of pi from this experiment, by simulation. And then you can do another thing, you can animate that little problem opens needle and such like of stuff. So I have already given two lectures on Monte Carlo simulation, and that are basically based on point tossing phenomena and estimate the value of pi using Monte Carlo integration, and also on Monte Carlo that randomly throwing point in the into a square inside a circle, and then the circle inside the square. That thing I have already described earlier. So if you haven't watched that thing, please go to the go to my YouTube channel and watch that video, and that will be helpful for you before watching this video. So and that will be a good practice to for you also. So now so if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, please subscribe to my channel, and I will give some videos on I will upload more videos on Monte Carlo simulation later. And thank you for watching. If you like the video, please share, and thank you.